Good evening. Welcome. I'm Joshua Decter, the director of the Master of Public Art Studies program at the USC Rossi School of Fine Arts. Thank you very much for being here this evening at this Visions and Voices event. I have a very, very brief introduction for tonight's event, and then we will have presentations from our distinguished guests and a discussion at the table, and then I will open it up for discussion with the audience. At least that's the planned format, and we will try to stick with that. This is an architecture in the public sphere of cities, the first panel discussion of a two-part event, Participation in Friction, Rethinking Art and Architecture as Public Culture. The second panel discussion of this event will take place here at 7 p.m. on Monday, April 6th, entitled Architecture, Design, Art, Strategies for Survival. I would like to extend my thanks and gratitude to the leadership of USC's Visions and Voices initiative for making this event possible, in particular Dara Yudakovsky and Barry Glasner, and to the members of the faculty committee who supported my proposal for these events. My thanks also to Dean Ruth Weisberg of the Rossi School of Fine Arts for her continued support for this event and my program generally. I'm appreciative that Homera Goldstein, who's a major benefactor of our program, is also here. I want to thank my faculty, my students, and the overall Rossi School faculty for being supportive in my first year and a half here in this position. A very special acknowledgement to my program coordinator, Elizabeth Lovins, without whom this event would not be possible. I really want to thank our panelists tonight, Doug Aitken, Anne Pasternak, and Peter Zellner, for being with us and for sharing their practices and perspectives with us. And again, thank you for all of you for being here at USC to participate in the event tonight. I'm gonna introduce each of the panelists in one moment. I'm gonna read some prepared lines which just offer a very brief and cursory overview of what tonight's event begins and what the April event will continue. And what I've tried to do is organize two discussion events which present, I think, a kind of multiple ideological, artistic perspective on questions of art and architecture in the public sphere. Obviously, we're living in very challenging times on many levels, as you all well know. And the events tonight and in April were organized to try and rethink an ongoing issue, an issue which concerns the program that I'm directing here specifically, which is the impact, if we can talk about the impact of art and architecture in terms of public space, public sphere, and the social. Now, this can mean many different things to many different people, depending upon one's cultural perspective, ideological perspective, so on and so forth. But we're trying to give examples of how these distinct practices might be able to perhaps suggest a transformative effect upon citizens within particular urban situations. And maybe to think about a question. Is it the responsibility of artists, architects, curators, organizers, critics, and others to help reconstitute an apparently waning critical public sphere? If so, how might this be accomplished? Now, there have been discussions in many parts of culture in this country and elsewhere about the death of the public sphere for at least 30 to 40 years, if not longer. And I think tonight what we can talk a little bit about in relation to Doug Aitken's work, Peter Zellner's architectural practice, and And Pasternak's work as curator and organizer is to really consider what's at stake in terms of artists and architects who are working in relation to different conditions within public space, and obviously encountering different challenges in terms of the manifestation of projects and in terms of different constituencies and publics. I will now introduce each panelist, and then we can proceed to their individual presentations. Anne Pasternak, who came in from New York for our event, is the president and artistic director of Creative Time in New York. And I met Anne, I think, originally about 20 years ago in New York, so we go back quite a while. Some of the renowned projects under her direction include exhibitions and performances in the historic Brooklyn Bridge, Anchorage, new sculpture in Grand Central Station, paintings in Coney Island, skywriting over Manhattan, and the Tribute in Light project at Ground Zero, the twin beacons of light that illuminated the former World Trade Center 6 months after 9/11. Pasternak has been committed to initiating projects that give artists the opportunity to innovate their practice, celebrate New York life, and reflect on contemporary society while engaging millions of people with art that permeates everyday urban life. And Anne has, under her direction of Creative Time, really moved Creative Time also out of New York. They've been doing projects in various locations, in Los Angeles, in Denver during the DNC, and in other situations which she will talk about. Doug Aitken is a LA and perhaps occasionally other based artist who actually I met for the first time when Doug was, I think, a student at CalArts. Was it Art Center?
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah. There we go. I'm a transplanted New Yorker, so I always make these mistakes.
They're all the same.
But it was, yeah, exactly, we're all the same. So I think I made a studio visit with Doug at that point, and I think he was living maybe in Venice at that point or something of that effect. So that was a long time ago as well. Doug's practice has really been sort of at the leading edge of 21st century communication on many levels, utilizing a wide array of artistic approaches. His eye leads us into a world where time, space, and memory are fluid concepts. Doug has had many exhibitions around the world, including the Museum of Modern Art, the Sleepwalker's project that will be discussed tonight, as Creative Time and MoMA collaborated with Doug on this, the Pompidou Center in Paris, and the 1999 Venice Biennale, where he won the international prize for his acclaimed installation, Electric Earth. So welcome, Doug. And Peter Zellner. Peter is an architect, founding practice of ZELLNERPLUS, an LA-based architectural design firm that has executed public and private art galleries, residences, institutional facilities, and corporate spaces in LA, San Francisco, and New York City. ZELLNERPLUS spaces include the Sweeney Art Gallery for UC Riverside, the Red Cat Lounge and Bar at Disney Concert Hall, as well as projects for Napster, LAX Art, Harris Lieberman, and Macaroni Inc. He also coordinates a sci-fi program at SciArc with David Bergman. So please welcome our panelists tonight, and thanks again for being here. So we're going to start with Anne.
So I'm just curious, before we get started, how many of you are students in the program here? How many of you are students not in the program here? So nice to see so many students. How many working artists that are not students? Who are the rest of you? Well, welcome. I'm so glad you're here. I have some friends here. Hi, Carter. Hi, Carol. Hi, Susan.
Yeah.
OK, go with my first slide. You'll see how great and sophisticated my
Let me fix it for you.
my PowerPoint skills are. So, hi, I'm Anne. I'm happy to be here. Josh, thank you very much for having me. It's great to be with old friends like Josh and with Doug. And you know, in fact, and new friends like Peter. In fact, when, you know, for years I was trying to work with Doug. I also knew him when he was a student. I just want you to know. And when I'd say to Doug, let's do, you know, a public project, he said to me, I'll never forget this. I don't know if you remember it, Doug. He said, I don't do public art. And I said, I don't either. So it's really interesting that so many of you are in this public art study program, and I'm curious if you do public art. But it's really been changing since that time. That was a long time ago. That was like 12 years ago. Let's go to the next slide. So Josh asked me to be sort of the generalist. That's not his language, it's mine, but the generalist in the group, and talk a little bit about creative time and its history. And so what I thought I'd do is my normal sort of presentation, condensed in 20 minutes. I could speak really fast. If you don't understand something, interrupt me. Who's going to be my timekeeper? Will you be my timekeeper?
That's okay, I'll do it.
You're going to do it? Yeah. No, I want to give somebody in the audience a job.
Okay.
All right. But if he doesn't do his job, then you let him know, Josh, okay?
Okay.
So, so Creative Time was founded 35 years ago, 1972, 1973. And, you know, there was public art that was really kind of blossoming in the country, in America, around that time. And we tended to think about it in terms of these great, big, ambitious, gorgeous, luscious sculptures by famous artists. Of course, Chicago was the best city of this. Of course, this is the Alexander Calder. And they kind of became like postage stamps of or logos for cities, places that you would be proud of because there'd be a big, famous sculpture and tourists would come to see them. And they just sort of perked up a otherwise banal public municipal site. Let's go to the next slide, Josh. And of course, Chicago's continued this kind of trajectory with this Anish Kapoor sculpture in Millennium Park. Next slide. But Creative Time came out of a very different kind of time period. New York City, 1972, 1973, was really all about, or so I'm told, you know, this kind of energy of experimentation and sort of taking apart boundaries and trying new things. And so, you know, of course, it was the time of glam rock. Now, those of you who are older than 25, please do not answer this question. Anybody know who this is? Any of the students? Okay, good. I'm glad. Okay, next. I'm going to stump you soon. Okay, how many of you know who this is? Oh, but you were probably older than 25. Yes, Gloria Steinem. So it's a time of the women's rights movement, really in high gear, people believing that they could make change, they did make change. Let's keep going. I just really like this slide. We were founded the same year as the Watergate scandal, and I don't know what Elvis was doing with Nixon, but at any rate, and the end of the Vietnam War era. And of course, this was a time of great artistic experimentation. This slide is a little bit older. I think this was a Alan Capro happening from the late 1960s. But this was a time that artists were going outside of their studio. They were collaborating with different disciplines like dance and theater and poetry. And they were making things happen in unlikely places, from strange urban places to even suburban places. Let's keep going. And of course, it was the time of land art. How many of you have been to see Spiral Jetty? Just a few of us. Quite worth it. Okay, keep going. Doug, you haven't been there?
No, it's on my journey.
Okay, good. But New York City really, was in a very, very bad state. It was on the verge of bankruptcy, and the city was really falling apart. Let's keep going. And subways are, I hope, not going to return back to that. And it was a time period, I don't know why I have these slides there. They're kind of in the wrong order, but the point was is that, we'll get back to that later. Let's keep going forward. I'm going to skip over those and we might go back. Skip over the gates and the waterfalls. Okay, this is where I want to go. So there were these people in New York City who worked for Koch. They were city officials, bureaucrats in the best sense of the term, and they really believed that art could do something to sort of counter the mass exodus of businesses and families leaving Manhattan. And what they did is they offered artists these corporate lobby buildings to create temporary installations. This is a project actually by Red Grooms. It was his famous Ruckus Manhattan project, where he took over down in the Wall Street area a corporate lobby for a two-year period and turned it into a studio. And the idea was to kind of take the artistic process outside of the privacy of the studio, make it more public, demystify artistic practice, take the artist off their pedestal, and really enliven urban space and invite the public to come in and participate. Let's keep going. keep going. Still Ruckus Manhattan. There's Ed Koch getting the mayor the keys to Ruckus Manhattan, Red Grooms' Manhattan. And then over time, you know, after a few years, Creative Times founders decided that they wanted to move beyond sort of these corporate lobbies down in Lower Manhattan. Does anybody know where this is? Carol, you can't answer. Oh, that was so good. Yes, it was Art on the Beach on a landfill that was created from the excavation of the World Trade Center site, which is today Battery Park City and the World Financial Center. And so we went from inside spaces in Lower Manhattan to outside spaces in Lower Manhattan. And there, it was all about artistic experimentation. It was about having artists collaborate with performance artists and architects to create new kinds of projects on this vacant landfill, this vacant strip downtown. This is a project by LA performance artist John Malpied and the architect Erica Rothenberg and, artist Erica Rothenberg and architect Lori Hawkinson. It's called the Freedom of Expression National Monument. Let's keep going. It's hard to imagine Lower Manhattan once looked like this, not so long ago. And then over time, by the mid-80s, Creative Times started to diversify outside of Lower Manhattan, including into Brooklyn. This is a project in the early 90s, the 42nd Street Art Project, where we took over a strip of 42nd Street between 7th and 8th Avenues for 2 years to create artist interventions. 1 year on the theater marquees, we had haiku poems, and the other year was Jenny Holzer truisms. Let's keep going. Tibor Kalman, legendary art director, a sign that he had created and set up shop for Shoeshine Guys. Of course, Tom Otterness is in the foreground and Jenny Holzer on the marquees. And Creative Times still programs in Times Square today, actually not on the Panasonic screen. When we were working with Panasonic for 7 years, that was the biggest, most central screen in Times Square. It's now the smallest screen. Within about 3 years, it became the smallest screen, and there are about five screens above it. But we're now on the MTV screen, and we do short videos with artists every hour during the programming cycle. And so this is officially Advice cat drinking milk, monster size. Okay. So, Creative Time had these kind of values, this idea from the very beginning that art was important to the city, art can enliven public space, that artists should experiment and activate public space as spaces for sort of creative freedom, but also really felt that that art in the public realm, that artists are important, that they matter in society. I'm not saying that they're at the forefront of any movements. I don't necessarily believe that at all. But that they are important to movements, and they're important to consciousness raising, and they're important to democracy. And so Creative Time felt so strongly about this that we really became sort of a catalyst in many ways of helping artists engage mass audiences with timely issues that they were concerned about. So while we were doing sculptures and performances and all sorts of things in public spaces like 42nd Street or Lower Manhattan, the truth is we were also trailblazing some other places like mass media spaces. And we did this at especially politically active time. If you think about the mid-late 1980s with the HIV and AIDS pandemic, sort of the third wave of feminism, environmental concerns, racial parity concerns, there was a kind of moment that felt very political in the art world, and Creative Time became a kind of central place for artists to turn and help share their ideas in the public realm outside of speaking to, the converted, supposedly, within the galleries or alternative art spaces. So it was like taking that alternative art space kind of activist spirit, but out into the streets. Does that make sense? Yeah. So this is a project by artist Grand Fury. They included artists like Donald Moffitt and Bob Gober. It was a campaign that they had done to appropriate Benetton ad campaigns to raise awareness about the transmission of HIV and AIDS. It was incredibly shocking in the late 1980s to see this. I remember I had just moved to New York, and my father had said to me, "Annie, when you move to New York, please only hug your gay friends, do not kiss them." And then I saw this. You know, he was all serious. He was a really, like, open-minded guy. It was just that there was so much misinformation out there, you know? And I saw this, and I, you know, started going to ACT UP meetings and became an activist. This completely changed my life. Next slide. These are a little out of order, but this is when I came to Creative Time. Does anybody know who this is? I think I might have heard the name. It's Karen Finley. Do any of you remember who Karen Finley is? I sure hope so. Very important artist in my life because she was the first woman who expressed female rage really powerfully. Karen was one of those artists who was really censored in the late 1980s at a time of incredible conservatism throughout the United States. And artists were being demonized as unpatriotic. And it was around the time that the far right was trying to dismantle the National Endowment for the Arts and museums and other kinds of public cultural institutions. And Karen and a few other artists, three other artists, had received grants from the National Endowment for the Arts. And then they were rescinded because the artists were deemed to be obscene. I don't know if putting yams up your butt is obscene. I don't know. What do you think, Josh? So at any rate, so all of a sudden, you know, she had this thriving career, and she was performing at, you know, great concert halls, sellout crowds, and everything was going great until this moment where Karen was turned into, like, America's, you know, worst enemy. And nobody would show her anymore because all the institutions, were big and small, were afraid of losing their funding and you know, horrible sort of public campaigns against them by the religious right. And so what happened was these artists sued the National Endowment for the Arts, and their case was being heard by the Supreme Court. It's kind of a long story. I'm going to get through it. And but the press wouldn't talk to her. They just kept demonizing her. So she had no outlets. We created a 1-900 telephone number for her. And every day she recorded her thoughts about the hearings and also performed new work so she could still have an audience and people could call in. And, you know, the $600 we made a month went to Karen for a fee. At any rate, that was a long story, but I liked that project. It was the first one of the first projects I did at Creative Time. So there's, like, this whole idea about having artists really participate without fear in society, in public discussion. Let's keep going. It's a project by an artist named Peggy Diggs on milk cartons, next slide, about domestic violence. May not be the most beautiful of artworks, but it was a very powerful message. This was before the O.J. Simpson, Nicole Brown tragedy. And, you know, domestic abuse was not a household word. And, you know, you get your milk anywhere in New York State, New Jersey, or Connecticut, and you have a little message about domestic abuse as an artwork. Keep going. And then Creative Time still sees itself as a very timely, responsive kind of organization. This was the Tribute in Light 6 months after 9/11 that sort of reclaimed our city skyline and memorialized lives lost and honored the workers and recovery effort downtown. Keep going. Keep going. Jenny Holzer, during the 2004 election season, projections of poems by poets, deceased and present, who wrote poems about their love of home, and home usually involved places that were under attack at war. So those happened all over the city. And then the week of the election, I couldn't resist having these banners. Abuse of power comes as no surprise, flying over the skyline.
Which election? I'm sorry.
It's 2004.
2004.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I'm in LA. I forgot. Just joking. Keep going. So the other thing that's really important to Creative Time is experimentation. And a really great site where we started doing very experimental work was the Brooklyn Bridge Anchorage. This is the Brooklyn Bridge on the Brooklyn side of the bridge. And let's go to the next slide. And inside there were these incredible sort of, you know, 50-foot high vaulted limestone and brick chambers. It's the first time Doug and I worked together was actually at the Anchorage, this sound piece. And here was an opportunity, you know, to try to do things that weren't happening in the galleries or the other alternative art spaces, to sort of put our finger on a moment of, you know, what was happening, an emerging sort of cultural activity that was being ignored or not yet recognized by the mainstream. That was an installation by Martin Margiela, okay. Erwin Reddell, LED lights, get a sense of the scale of the space. And Maura Sheehan's Culture Bridge, which actually was a half pipe. There wasn't a half pipe in New York City for like a 200-mile radius outside of New York City, so we built one in the Anchorage. Okay. And so, you know, I really take this sort of this responsibility of having artists, opportunities for artists to experiment and to do things that they haven't done before very seriously. It's my primary passion at Creative Time. And so I love to go to artists who say to me, like Doug did and like Vic Muniz did, I don't do public art, and ask them to do public projects when I think for some reason it makes some perverse sense. This was Vic Muniz's first public project. It was skywriting a cloud across New York City. And he's always interested in the temporary nature of drawing. And he was interested in how people would sort of subjectively read into this image of a simple cartoon-like cloud. And it was amazing the stories that we got. People just sent us letters and poems and paintings and their kids' drawings of their experiences. And, you know, we heard all sorts of things like, did anybody see the penis in the sky today? Or did anybody see the heart in the sky? I told my girlfriend I did it for her and proposed. And one of my favorites was this restaurateur who was in his 40s, very successful, who had suddenly died of a brain aneurysm. And his family was, he was a big Yankees fan. He had box seats at the Yankees, so he must have been a really successful restaurateur. And his family was driving out after the funeral service to the burial in Westchester, and they were going by Yankee Stadium, and they saw a baseball mitt in the sky, and they thought it was a sign from their son. And it wasn't until they saw this in the New York Times that they realized it was actually a cloud, and it was an artwork. But at any rate, there's all these wonderful kinds of dynamics that are completely unpredictable that happen when you work in the public realm. And, you know, at Creative Time, we always say that if an artist hasn't done something before and we love that artist and the idea, we're, like, really turned on. And if we haven't done it ourselves before, then we're going to do it. So let's keep going. This is Cy Kuo Chiang's Explosion, his light cycle piece, which I could talk about for hours, so I'm not going to now. But it was for the 150th anniversary of Central Park. It was a 1,000-foot circle being drawn by fireworks for the first time ever. It took 25 computers to tell, I can't remember how many cannons it was at this point, a whole lot of cannons, at what point to release the shells, at what time, moment for the shells to stop, and at what point for them to actually explode. Nothing like this had been done before, and in just a 13-second pass, more fireworks were being exploded than the entire 4th of July Macy's fireworks display. In fact, no fireworks had ever been intentionally exploded in that quantity before that moment. But that's another story about when projects don't go the way you planned. But I loved it. Okay, keep going. Doug, I'm going to have you talk about sleepwalkers, but you know, one of my favorite projects ever, and I'm not just saying it because Doug is here, was working with Doug on sleepwalkers. And you know, you'll hear him talk about how he wanted to have buildings come to life and make, you know, human presence active on the surface of these sort of glass and steel architecture. Well, he'll show it to you. It was quite a breathtaking experience. So this is an installation shot of sleepwalkers on the exterior of MoMA. Another one. And another one. And Doug, you probably have the same slides to show, right? OK, so next. Since we're talking about architecture, I wanted to throw in this recent slide. This very modest little organ is a project by the artist David Byrne. And David and I scouted locations in New York City for almost 2 years before we found the Battery Maritime Building, which hasn't been open to the public in probably half a century. And the back of the organ is removed, and he has tubes hooked up to the backs of keys. And those tubes go off to different architectural elements in the building. So for example, water pipes and radiators and columns. And so solenoids would tap the columns, or air would blow into the pipes, and so it sounded like a flute. And it really turned the entire space into a musical instrument, where you're activating the sort of inherent properties of sound in a space that had been sort of long forgotten. Really beautiful space. Keep going. Yeah, towards the back.
Didn't look like David Byrne.
No, that was not David. In fact, David never played it in front of anybody, including me. Okay. That's not true. He played it with the mayor. Okay, so last year, Creative Time started to work nationally. It seemed that if we were really privileging the artist and the artist process and the artist's ideas, we should not be limited to place. We should respond to where artists wanted to work. This is a project by an artist named Paul Chan, and it took place in New Orleans around the second anniversary after Hurricane Katrina. And Paul, when he first went to New Orleans about a year after Katrina, thought it reminded him of every experience of, he'd been to war-torn places like Baghdad. He was involved with the bombings and protests in Vieques. And he said, the truth is that New Orleans had reminded him of something else. And the thing that it had reminded him of was every production of Samuel Beckett's Waiting for Godot that he had ever seen. And it seemed like that theme of waiting was a perfect way to kind of build a spotlight and take a look through a lens at the condition of New Orleans and the state in crisis for the people of New Orleans. So we went ahead and decided that we would talk to people in New Orleans and see if they wanted us to present outdoors in the devastated Lower Ninth Ward, as well as another neighborhood, Gentilly, this production of Waiting for Godot. And it was a really, really breathtaking experience because the whole project really was dependent on listening. Sharing with people an idea and really listening to their response and really hearing them and responding to their responses and designing a project that became so much better because people had thoughts. Like, for example, if you're going to produce a play here, you have to do it New Orleans style. You got to have some food and music. There's definitely no music in Godot, so we had bands beforehand, and we had free gumbo. We basically moved to New Orleans. My staff was there for every week, on and off, for about 6 months. Paul, though, had been there nonstop for over 4 months. He just moved to the community. He showed up every day. 5 minutes? Great, I'm almost done. Showed up every day, had a kind of courage and integrity that I'd never seen before of just really being present in people's lives. And people had said to us, there's no community for theater in New Orleans, so if you have 75 people show up, you should be really happy. And just in case, we built seating for about 500 people, and it turned out we had several thousand people a day who came far and wide. For many of them, it was the first time back to the neighborhood since the hurricane. And every day we had to turn away thousands of people. But the thing is that it's not that it's a success because we turn people away, but it was that community building, that kind of really being a part of the community in the neighborhood and really listening meant so much to a project like this and was a really breathtaking process for all of us who were involved and really changed us deeply. So this is the main cast for Waiting for Godot in the Lower Ninth. This is some of the party beforehand. Musicians, cast, Susan Gentilly, and project that's coming to LA soon is a project by an artist named Jeremy Deller. It's going to land at the Hammer Museum. It's starting at the New Museum next week. And basically what Jeremy is interested in is privileging conversation with everyday folk. And so what we're doing is we've acquired this bombed out car that was a casualty of a notorious bombing in Baghdad outside of like the sort of intellectual sort of hub of Baghdad where the poets hung out, a lot of booksellers were, a lot of artists hung out, and about 30 people had been killed in this bombing. And so what he's doing is he's renting this RV. And on the side of it says conversations about Iraq. And on the back of the RV is going to be on a trailer, this car. And we're going down south, cross country, over a 3-week period, till we land in LA. And Jeremy, along with an Iraqi refugee and a soldier who did two tours in Iraq, and our curator, Nato Thompson, will just be, you know, in front of schools and universities and, you know, military bases and communes and music festivals and county fairs and all sorts of places for a three-week period. So I think it arrives here maybe around April 18th or 19th, and then that night Jeremy and Nato and, you know, their fellow travelers will have a conversation about their experiences on the road, so you guys will get to hear about it first.
Is that the
This is map? The route that, yeah, this okay. is the route that we're taking. Okay, so just to kind of sum up, you've seen that Creative Time has this incredible sort of range of approaches. We're a very unpredictable kind of organization, and the reason is we follow artists and what artists are really excited about. And, you know, we trust them to take us to new places. We trust them to take our audiences to new places. And in the process, they really keep our city alive with creativity. I believe that their, you know, their interaction, their involvement in the public realm is fundamentally a democratic act. It keeps difference alive within our public spaces. And those are just a few of the important values at Creative Time. Wow, that's hard to do.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you. So we're going to switch computers so that Doug can do his presentation. I forgot to make a quick announcement, which is really more pertaining to when we open up for questions from you. We're filming this event for documentation purposes for both our program and for the university as a whole, and we will be running an edited version of our conference on our program's website, just to alert you to this, so that when, if you know, you do ask questions, that you will be documented. If you have any issues with this, please come and speak with us after the event. Thanks very much. Are we good?
Yeah.
Okay. Doug Aitken.
Hi, I'm just really impressed by Anne, I always have to say, whenever I hear you talk.
You're my inspiration.
You're the inspiration for all of us. Anyways, thanks for coming tonight. I am not so much of a performer, so I'm going to hide behind the microphone and, you know, kneel down underneath this cotton sheet if you don't see me so well. But I'll show you a little bit of work, work from the past, present, and probably some projects from the future. And I want to bring this back to a really early piece that was quite important for me, that was kind of a crossroads between work in a more sculptural way and then kind of discovering the filmic medium. I saw that the symposium is about, it says architecture and public culture, Josh. So I somehow felt that this piece had something to do with public culture because it kind of went into the public unexpectedly.
I apologize, and I said CalArts. I apologize.
So anyways, this nearly monochrome screen, which I'm showing you, is actually a still from a piece from 1994. And this piece, Inflection, was the first filmic piece which I'd worked on. And this piece, I found that my hands were tied with many of the solid mediums at the time, sculpture, or photography, or painting, or anything like that. And I needed something that was that could kind of capture the fluidity, the kind of time-based quality of life. And I wanted to do this project where, and this made me think of some of Anne's collaborations with, you know, kind of subcultures in the world. I wanted to do this collaboration with a group of men from like NASA and JPL that built these high-powered missiles in their backyards and launched them in the desert on weekends. And this is obviously like, you know, quite a while before 9/11. And I thought it was very strange, this kind of desire to transcend through technology, to build something with no scientific purpose, just to get as high as possible. So we created a missile with a high-speed surveillance camera inside it and launched it above the suburban neighborhood that it was created in. So that's what's happening here. I want to kind of just go through these works and talk about architecture a bit. This work, These Restless Minds, worked with a series of rural farm auctioneers from the Midwest and the Appalachians. And these people, men and women, kind of, you know, speak in this incredibly fast chant. And, you know, I worked with them, filming them kind of in their own landscape, whether it was a parking lot to a 7-Eleven or some other kind of very banal part of the landscape. And, you know, they just kind of merged with it. So like a kind of electronic poetry, in a sense, high-speed haikus. This is the work Electric Earth. This is an installation here, I think, perhaps this is at the Stedelijk Museum here, or maybe in Venice Biennale. And with this work, it was quite important for me to increasingly challenge the idea of film, the restrictions that I saw in film at the time. And in saying that, also to try to find a way to open up access to the content of a work in a different sort of way to the viewer. I was very interested in trying to break the screen, break the glass, find a way to have the content and the content and concepts of work really kind of pour into the viewer, as opposed to having a kind of critical distance between something which is perhaps hanging on the wall and the viewer's gaze. This work was quite immersive. It was very architectural. It was a series of rooms that you kind of walk through. And as you do so, you're following almost a day in the life of this young man that you see here, and he kind of wakes up from this gaze. He's fallen asleep watching the snow of the television. As he steps outside, he recognizes that he's the last person on Earth, and the cities are completely electronic, and all the electronic pulses come to life. The light starts flickering, and you know, 80 beats per minute. His body moves with that tempo. It's a very kind of hypnotic, synchronized world, and it's a world very much where the individual is at times incredibly in sync and other times left behind. And it was a work for me that was very much about the exploration of speed and temporality. Another still from it, another installation view. Here I think it's just numbers from a gas pump that just suddenly cut to the screen and start counting down at some kind of incredibly fast rate. This is an Ad Reinhardt. This is a work, I don't know why I'm trying to come into the public here, the public culture part of this. I a long time ago, I had to do this workshop up in this French school in Grenoble, and a couple other artists were up there, Pierre Huyg and Philippe Perino, and they were kind of depressed. They were teaching, and they said, you know, can you do anything here? Can you do anything with this situation? And I went into this class that I was supposed to deal with for like a couple days, and you know, and it was kind of guys in black turtlenecks, chain smoking with bad attitudes, and you know, these girls that just looked like they were really miserable. And it was apparent that there wasn't much of a connection happening. So I suggested to the principal, I guess you'd say, of the school, that perhaps maybe I should either leave or he should get a helicopter. And he thought this was kind of an extravagant American request, like maybe I'd take this helicopter and leave. But I assured him that the next morning it would be okay if we could only get the students and take them maybe 2 or 3 hours into the mountains and then just leave them there. He wasn't so into that idea either at first, but it all worked out. The next morning, we kind of took this mission, and we drove and drove and eventually hiked into this, like, completely white valley where there was no representational imagery, and we got into the center of the valley, and maybe 10 people, we all kind of, you know, huddled around. It was pretty cold, and they said, so what are we doing here? And I said, you're going to talk. Now you just have to talk. There's nothing else to do. It's just you, and you can look also. And then at that moment, this helicopter kind of came over the Alps like some scene from Apocalypse Now, and I think freaked out a lot of them. And then it kind of landed, and one by one, we took each student up into the mountains to kind of have an aerial view of everyone else. So that's the long story here, but somehow it relates to a larger philosophy that I hope feeds into these works. This was a piece that was at MoCA, Blow Debris. After doing Electric Earth, which was very much about the urban landscape, I wanted to do something that, kind of dealt with the idea of the individual in a different way. So it kind of just let the... I worked with a squatter community in the desert in the Salton Sea. I spent about 4 or 5 months down there. It was my bad decision to do that during summer. And you know, kind of worked with this whole community of, pretty much homeless people to become my cast. And just in the piece, they really kind of merged into the desert itself. Eventually, the work comes into these kind of suburbs of Southern California and these inside the suburban homes, which disintegrate. They explode and disintegrate into kind of a dust cyclones. Coming back to architecture as public culture, I found that these installations I'd been making were increasingly moving into architectural directions. They're increasingly experiments. I've always seen artworks as experiments and not an attempt to make something that's finished or a closed system, but more a provocation. And I was offered to do an exhibition at this museum in London called the Serpentine Gallery. The shows that I had seen there had always been very much painting or quite formal exhibitions. There's a beautiful space in the park. And I wanted to do something quite different. I wanted to use solar energy to create this searchlight lighthouse from the top that illuminated the park at nighttime. And then when you went inside the space, you would have to kind of, you cut a hole in the floor, so you had to kind of go underground into the sub-basement, which had, you see here, which had all the kind of heating and cooling for the park. And this is sections of a piece which I shot in Antarctica. And then you kind of surface inside the museum, and it kind of becomes a series of rooms. That was, the title of the show is New Ocean, and I really wanted to kind of create this this fictional world that was kind of, you know, a kind of river of information and influence, and nothing was static in it. And the work kind of fused pop culture to landscape, to fictional landscape, to documentary. It was kind of a huge hybrid. The work traveled to 5 or 6 countries, and in each country and museum it went to, I also want to challenge the museum system of how work is seen publicly. And often exhibitions travel, and they're kind of like a package, and each museum gets them in the same way with minor modifications. I wanted to reinvent the body of work at each stop and remix everything from the sound to the video, or add new works or pull out old ones. So this is it in Kunsthaus Bregenz. This is a different work in a Kunstwerke Berlin, which kind of is used suburban building materials to house this work. I'm in You, which kind of follows this girl who's kind of like engaged, this young girl who's kind of engaged in this like incredibly heightened perception, and everything becomes kind of alive until eventually she falls asleep, and the house that she's sleeping in is severed from its foundation, put on wheels, and it just disappears down the freeway. Some sketch that, I don't know, some too much coffee. But I think that sketch led into this piece, which is a piece, New Skin, about a young woman who's losing her sight, who starts trying to kind of take as much information as possible, but eventually comes to a crossroads as to what to retain and what to discard, the value of information, the editing of information. Books, I love books. I love printed matter. We must keep printed matter. Yes, yes, we need printed matter. We can't let this electronic world suffocate us. So this was a book. This was a book that was shaped in the silhouette of a man. The book was a film, but there was never a film. It was only a book, and it was Udo Kier, the German actor who has played one of my favorite roles, Andy Warhol's Dracula, was the boatman in Lars von Trier's Breaking the Waves. I had always really liked him. He, in this book, this fictional story, he became this businessman who kind of lived everywhere and nowhere and just traveled so fast. He challenged himself to just kind of break all limits and be completely nomadic. And eventually he woke up and he had transformed into the entire motel room that he was in, the carpet, the floor, the bed, the wall. And people in his life gradually randomly passed through this room. Another book here, page layouts from it, an installation, interiors. This piece This piece shot four stories in different parts of the world, very random. The piece was conceptually based on a kind of form of chaos theory as applied to narrative. And in these four different stories, maybe one in Tokyo, maybe one in the ghettos of Los Angeles, here you have this guy Andre, he's a musician, Andre 3,000, 2,000, however many thousands. The piece is, the stories are separate, but there's one kind of adhesive, which is sound. And in this work, there are certain moments, certain kind of narrative arcs where just literally the sound starts coming together, and a humming that he may be making somewhere fuses with a tempo of foot tapping in the Yokohama fish market, fuses with something, a rivet going into a helicopter, an antiseptically clean helicopter factory. So that was a work. Here you see a stack of paper not far from here on the other side of the Harbor Freeway that made me thinking about origami. So I found this man, Bennett, who's about 90 years old, and started coming down to the studio once a week or something. Amazing creature. He's this kind of American origami guru. And then we started thinking, you know, I started thinking about how these kind of abstract paper forms could be, could take on different geometric configurations, as you see here. And I started imagining how these could become different narratives, almost different stories to be told in different shapes. This is all coming back. I threw those images in today because I read this Architecture and Public Culture. So it seemed this is architecture. This is architecture. You can make it. There's a recession going on, and you can go and get paper, and you can make your own architecture. It's free. And I'll prove it to you. Okay, you see this? This is a city. It's a composite city of brutalist and utopian architecture, right?
Yes.
And you call 1-800-GO-FEDEX, and they'll deliver these materials to your house or your studio. And this is a life-size city. Well, not life-size. It's maybe 30 feet wide out of FedEx boxes that took us about 4 months to construct by hand, architectural models that then became a bird aviary. And you can get all the materials you want for free. They deliver to your studio. It's fantastic. So if everything else fails, remember, FedEx is an incredible resource. This is a rough sketch because I can't remember the year, 2002 or something, I was asked to do the American Pavilion at the Venice Biennale. And I had two proposals that were on the board, and they were both, one was accepted, and then it was pulled out of the running at the last minute because the museum that was supporting me, I don't know, had a problem with it. They thought it was too controversial, but it was after, it was a go. But this was my first idea that in theory it was a good one, but they weren't so into the application. The idea was to completely remove the pavilion and just discard it, take the stones into storage in Venice, and then to make a sound piece. And you know, kind of use this site as a parkland with this kind of virtual aura of the architecture of the pre-existing pavilion, which was a very kind of drab and oppressive and imperialistic space. That sound piece led into this one. This is at Mies van der Rohe's Barcelona Pavilion. And once again, I had an opportunity to do a show there, and I couldn't bring myself to create something that was overtly visual. So I wanted to make something that worked on a sonic level instead. The different sides of this sculpture, it's a mobile that moves endlessly, and they all emit fragments of conversations, words and things like that. And as you kind of walk under it, it creates this kind of invisible, never-ending dialogue. It's a kind of Joycean piece in a certain way. This is a piece at Vienna Secession, always one of my favorite museums since I visited as a kid when it was in restoration. And I did a show inside the space, and I was planning it, and I asked the curator, I said, when does this museum close? And I became kind of troubled by this idea that a museum would close. I wanted to kind of make an insomniac museum. So when my show ended, the building would come to life, and it would go through about 2,000 different eyes that would shut, then a different eye, and it kind of would go all night, every night. It was the first outdoor piece I'd done.
What year is that, Brock?
That was like 98. Yeah, I think. And this is an exhibition that for the Arc. This is solid architecture, I'm telling you. It's in there somewhere. And a show, the Arc, the Musée de Ville de Paris. It's a museum in Paris. And 5 minutes.
Approximately.
I'm going to make it fast. So this is architecture. They said, you know, you have this space, and like the French Revolution took place outside, and it was this very formal kind of like stone building. And I thought that really like an exhibition could either address this, or it could be this kind of like a UFO that just landed inside, and you would never touch the actual space. So that's what this design is for. And we built this, and there was a series of three installations that went increasingly more rapid in terms of the content as you went through it. I'll blaze through these slides. This is a piece of the moment. It's 32 characters, people, different places that are all synchronized, and then they kind of go through different rhythms, patterns. It's something I'm very fascinated by right now, this idea of pattern repetition. I think with these works, I was much more interested in some of the compositions of, say, Eric Satie into Lamont Young or Terry Riley than I was in any art form. I really like very much kind of looking into different sectors outside of the arts. But this is an opera that we're composing in Manchester, but we're running out of time. This was a napkin that I showed Anne here.
I was wondering where that napkin was.
This is here. And the project that at MoMA that Anne had mentioned, Sleepwalkers, I found that one evening I walked outside of a restaurant and it was like 1 a.m, midtown, cold winter. I was walking to the subway and I just kind of stopped and I looked up at these buildings and I had this kind of hallucination that the buildings started becoming what was inside them. And, you know, you would see a photocopy machine with someone on it occupying a building. And over here you would find, you know, something else. And there was this incredible synchronicity running through the city. And I think I jotted it down and forgot about it for a couple of years. You know, without getting into it, one thing led to another. And incredibly amazing creature, MoMA facilitating it. And eventually this project came to fruition after a lot of urban spelunking and exploring the city. Here you have one of the characters played by Sean Marshall. And in this work, what I was interested in doing was creating a work that really came out of the city. It came out of the DNA of the pulse of the city. I didn't want it to be character studies of people so much as I wanted it to be a river, a kind of river of constantly changing tempos and patterns that came out of everything from the squelch of a subway car's metallic brakes to the pulsing of the traffic lights to a sound that you hear behind you and you think someone's pacing you. I wanted all of this kind of like celebratory to nervous energy to manic speeding time to empty contemplation to be kind of reflected in this piece. There were multiple stories with multiple people, however, everything's synchronized. So when you would see this work, it would constantly come up in different order, even though the patterns would somehow click and create a kind of synchronicity. It occupied 53rd and 54th Street, and this is a corridor on 6th Avenue that also went around. You see here on the left, you see Saint-Georges as a kind of Times Square worker, someone who's working inside the actual signs of Times Square, where we had access to the neon and electronics and the LED lights. You know, you have someone else again. You have Sean here, who's working inside the Queens Postal Facility, and she's sorting hand sorting these thousands of letters a day that are kind of going to different people. There's something very mechanized about it. You have, you know, this character here who's you know, kind of in this frozen world of Lincoln Town cars and, you know, automatic windows. And the piece, these people break their barriers and they kind of come into some kind of larger synchronicity. There were some public happenings. I've done quite a lot of public happenings. This was one at MoMA, a drum table that I created that had auctioneers in the audience that kind of sprouted up out of nowhere and started going into these high-speed chants. while these guys were jamming out. This, I found this picture today. It's amazing. You talk about this public art thing, and these are smoke signals, Native American smoke signals. I just thought they were kind of great. Somehow they had a reference to this other project that I'm kind of developing right now, where I'm trying to make a one-block-long cloud. We've been working on this for about a year. And these are some tests in the desert. These are some people for scale. And I wanted it to be something that could be really choreographed, opaque, and translucent. It has a different series of different rhythms that take place over an hour, and then eventually over the course of a month or so. And Anne, we have to talk about this later. This is a book, but it's spread out here. I'm going to speed through these light box. Series of 32 watercolors, but we can talk about these after. Repetition. Almost there, Josh. Okay. I'm almost there. Okay, New York City skyline that becomes a periscope that becomes several three-story high kaleidoscopes that shower the reflection of New York through this building. So you can look into it or it's above you. This is one before installation. So turning the city into a prism of abstraction. And I just wanted to kind of get to this point because this is a landscape in upstate New York, and it's a project that I started a little while ago where I wanted to kind of, we talk about public work, and we talk about public work as being something which, you know, maybe says something to the viewer, has a certain way of kind of getting at the viewer. And with this, I wanted to do something quite different. I wanted the work to disappear. I didn't want it to be high in volume, but I wanted it to be very quiet in volume. And it is a house on a 200-acre part of land that will eventually be a public museum. And I wanted to see if the only thing that's man-made on this property could vanish. So we spent a year filming this landscape from all four angles and delayed the construction of this building and modified the construction of this building to fit the aspect ratio of the film. So then from all angles, it becomes a void, a sort of hologram of its own disappearance, which feeds into this work, which is a mirrored pavilion and becomes a kind of anechoic chamber. And here, this we're working on in Seattle right now, but it's a completely silent place where you are only confronted with your own existence, your heartbeat, and your breath. This is another project. It's in France. This is work in Brazil. They'll be finished in 2 months. That goes 300 feet into the earth, and there's a hole that goes 300 feet into the earth, and at the bottom of it are a series of sensors that pick up the sound of the earth's rotation and the plates shifting, and they amplify it into this pavilion where there are about 30 speakers, which are hidden, and they, in real time, they constantly transmit the sound of the violence or the harmonics, what's happening beneath.
Where in Brazil is that?
It's in Belo Horizonte. It's in Bernardo Paz place.
Oh, right.
In the same space, this is an earth wall. And then this is the Carnegie International. I think this is closing right now, another performance. And these are some... This was a trajectory, this work migration went from the industrial northeast to the west coast and entirely inside motel and hotel rooms, bringing in, introducing indigenous American animals to these rooms and kind of creating this work out of it. So I'm almost done, so here you go. And then here it is in the gallery. And then that's it. This is another smoke signal. I'm up in smoke. Thank you for coming.
Before Peter, is the cloud piece, is that going to be a so-called materialized, dematerialized piece, or a projection piece, or an actual?
No, the cloud is an actual cloud.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll get back to that.
We're trying to tap into the steam in New York City. So we can use it in a green way.
Peter Zellner.
Hi. That was a tour de force, Doug, now that you're leaving. And now that I've lost my notes, that's a really hard act to follow, but I wanted to thank Anne for her presentation. Also, Doug, and of course, I wanted to thank Joshua and Elizabeth for organizing this evening. Somehow, I've managed to misplace my notes. First, I lost my phone. Now, I've lost my notes. But
want me to look in my bag again?
Did you hide them?
I don't think so, but let's see.
How did that happen?
Yeah.
Here they are. Anyway, briefly, because I know we don't have too much time, and I'm hoping that what I'll present this evening might lead on to our discussion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Obviously, I'm not an artist, and nor am I a curator. I'm an architect, and I'm a teacher. But my work has been focused primarily over the last 5 years in the design of private and public art spaces both on both coasts. And I suppose, coincidentally, a lot of the work has been done for young galleries, many of them in the Weavar district of New York, Harris Lieberman and Macaron, but also in the Culver City Arts District, where I've worked with the project and my partner, Lori Furstenberg's space, LAX Art. I've also done work at UC Riverside with the Sweeney Art Gallery. And I think what connects all those projects is that generally they've been kind of hinge projects that have been instrumentalized, I guess you might say, towards the development of new art districts. So in some ways, what I want to talk about tonight are a few questions that could build on the last presentations and allow us to move to sort of a shared discussion around the issues of cities, art, architecture, and culture. I guess those are the themes that Joshua gave us tonight. And in the process, I'll show you some of my own work, but I'll also show you some work that I developed with second-year architecture students here at USC when I was a visiting professor in 2007, 2008. So in some ways, I have a personal stake in the conversation, but I think it's important to understand that as an architect, quite often, I have been a facilitator, in some ways, of kind of urban situations that support art, less so a player, in some ways. So let me say I'm going to just pose a few questions, which I hope I'm going to answer tonight, or at least we can try to consider three of them. The first question I would like to pose for our consideration is this. Has art and architecture for art played a beneficial role in the development of existing cities, in particular Los Angeles? Is this not going to advance? Oh, I've got to do it manually. This only goes, it only plays. That's very weird. The second question, and I hope I can pause this. Oh, dear. Okay, we'll just leave it there for a second. I hate Max. Sorry. Anyway, the second question I wanted to ask was, can new forms of arts-based urban development engender more sustainable models of city formulation, models that value public interaction and community over commercial growth and private interests? And finally, in light of our current economic and perhaps cultural crises, what role should art and architecture occupy in the city now that cities, like many businesses and cultural organizations, are seeking a bailout? Certainly, I think, you know, a lot of us are trying to find something to do with themselves. It's a very interesting period of time. I would say that for me personally, the last 5 years were kind of a spectacular run. We produced about 12 art spaces, and then last September, everything sort of shut down. And it's left me personally as an architect wondering what to do next, and I think that it's an interesting time for us to recalibrate. And certainly to rethink perhaps our relationship to things like capital and culture. This is an ad by Blum and Poe of the culvert at the Bayona Creek, which runs underneath La Cienega in the Culver City Arts District. If any of you have made the trek from Suzanne Vielmetter's to LAX Art, you probably know the overpass. But it's an interesting way for a gallery to represent itself. And it says something about the relationship between particular galleries and urban spaces and the role in which galleries have taken, I guess, in kind of urban redevelopment. Certainly it seems today impossible for us to consider the transformation of cities without thinking about art. If we think about New York's Chelsea, Meatpacking and Soho districts, Berlin's Mitte, Mexico City's Condesa, Tokyo's Aoyama, Shanghai's French Concessionary, Miami's Art and Design District, our own Chinatown, or Culver City, it seems inconceivable that we cannot think about the remaking of these cities without discussing the remarkable informal synergy between commerce, culture, and urban redevelopment. Despite the usual absence of local, civic, and state design leadership, the art world has led, championed, and often pioneered the renewal and revitalization of former industrial districts. And this has often sort of surprised traditional planners and city makers, because lacking resources, official support, and access to public funding, artists and gallerists have led informal bottom-up redevelopments in areas long abandoned by civic leaders. In doing so, they have virtually bootstrapped entire urban districts and economies into the 21st century. So what we see here is a diagram that was developed by my students, and this is a sort of a time frame. It's a shot of the current state of what is called the Culver City Art District, and you'll see that basically in the cream color we have galleries. Everything else that's blue is residential. But essentially, you see the kind of intersection along Washington and La Cienega, which in 2000 was occupied primarily by light manufacturing and warehouse spaces, and now hosts something like 22 or 23 galleries. It's been well documented, but I'll sort of cover it here. CNN's travel department recently listed the Culver City Art District as one of the five Sohos of tomorrow.
Ouch.
Right? Like Atlanta's Castleberry Hill, Boston's South End, the Santa Fe Arts District, Philadelphia's Northern Liberties, Miami's Design District, and of course Chelsea and the Meatpacking districts in New York, the Culver City Art District inhabits a neighborhood that was once a thriving industrial warehouse zone, later a neglected neighborhood, and now experiencing rapid gentrification driven by art space redevelopment. In 2005, the New York Times declared the area along La Cienega and Washington Boulevards, just south of the 10, to be a nascent Chelsea. Whether or not this roughly 50 to 70 acre district, depending on how you measure it, is in need of comparison to New York's overheated art corridor may be moot by now. But as Tim Blum of Blum & Poe recently stated in the Los Angeles Times, you can't not go here anymore. It's definitely entrenched. It's a real community being promoted extensively all over the world. That's Tim Blum. This is a little study we did just to sort of see the breakout in the art district of uses. And by the way, this analysis was presented to the city of Culver City as a, which is tautological in itself. It was presented to the city of Culver City as a kind of long, short-term and long-range master plan, which they're still sort of thinking about. These are major corridors in the district. In any case, it's now officially being dubbed the Culver City Art District, even though something like 70% of it resides in the city of Los Angeles. In fact, all the galleries are by zone in the city of LA, not Culver City. Events such as the Culver City Arts Walk have been drawn up by local officials eager to connect the dots between the area's 25 white box galleries, restaurants, and cafes. But what has yet to be seen is if an arts-led revival of a decaying industrial zone can be parlayed into something sustainable and authentic, or if the area, like many other urban precincts first pioneered by artists, is merely ripe for imminent takeover by baby gaps and coffee beans. So what you see here, then, is a kind of analysis of galleries in Los Angeles on the left, and then a sort of breakout by percentage. You see the sort of two corridors, Washington, which is properly in Culver City, and La Cienega, which is actually in Los Angeles. I guess what is interesting is that given the sort of overheated nature of the last 8 years, this is an art district that kind of emerged fully formed. And I think we have to remember that Chelsea took something like 20 years to appear, and certainly Soho much longer. So it's clear that you know, given capital, things happen very quickly. But as you probably know, in the last 8 months, several galleries have already closed. So the question of its sustainability and long-term value to artists, I believe, in the community is certainly an issue we can discuss. Here you see an analysis we did of Santa Monica, East Los Angeles, and Culver City. And we compared from 1980 to 2030, projectively, the transfer of income, let's say, or the average median income differentials over time. And so what you see, for instance, is that Santa Monica in 1980 was considered 30% high income. By 2007, it was 60. Culver City is quite radical in the sense that developing real estate markets, I believe driven by sort of arts-based redevelopment, have forced a kind of evacuation of lower-income residents. And so in some senses, the question of whether or not arts-based redevelopment actually promotes economic parity or promotes disparity would be worth discussing further. I'll go back a step. Despite or perhaps because of all the hyperbole surrounding the meteoric rise of the Culver City Art District as LA's favorite new art venue, scarce attention has been paid either within the city of Culver City or the city of Los Angeles Planning Department as to the long-term sustainability, let alone short-term consequences of the rush to brand the area as an art district. The concern of any artist or veteran gallerist is the cyclical and uneven nature of art-driven gentrification. Just as Venice Beach was once an artist's refuge, the now trendy Santa Fe Arts District in downtown was also home to artist studios and galleries, most famously the home for Lace, which later moved to Hollywood. As a result, however, of the late, let's say, mid-80s to early 1990s and early 2000 real estate boom, artists and galleries were priced out of these areas and forced to move to cheaper rental districts. The cumulative effect in Los Angeles, at least, has been a sort of urban hopscotch played out between artists and developers. Given the success of the Culver City Arts District, it's clear that the pump is primed for the cycle to repeat itself. The district receives an estimated 2,000 visitors annually for its art walk and has attracted national attention. This also means more businesses are ready to move into the area, driving up property values and rents. Inevitably, new restaurants, office spaces, apartments, condos, and lofts will be crafted for an increasingly non-arts-based and, in fact, artist-free community. Now, that may change, but I think the point I'm making here is that artists, for better or worse, are quite often the shock troops who prime real estate for developers, and it's happened sequentially across North American cities. What I'd like to discuss today is whether or not there is a means to projectively consider art as something that could be developed sustainably, which means long-term, and also to consider that art is not merely a vehicle for the production of capital, but also of culture. And I think you said that artists should be involved in the making of cities, and I believe that in some ways we have an opportunity now to think about art and culture not in terms of its capital value, but in terms of its cultural value. So with that, I'm going to show you just a few projects really briefly. This is a sort of list of all the art spaces we've produced on both coasts. My office has been fortunate to have worked with a number of public clients like CalArts and OCMA, as well as a number of young galleries. We're currently producing a space for Wall Space in Chelsea, which will open next month. But you see here, I mean, I think an interesting, and this is a little autobiographical, a graph of all the work that we've done for art and not for art. There was a peak in 2008, and of course we're sort of in a downswing right now. But in any case, the preponderance of work that we've done in the office has been art-related. And these are some plan studies, basically, of all the galleries we've produced at scale. And you can see here, on the far right, a very large space we just did for Art LA. So this is sort of every space we've done since 2000. And four, starting with the project in Culver City and terminating with Photo Miami and Photo LA, which appear to be the last art projects we'll do for a while. But this is all the gallery wall length that we've done. we started with about 648 linear feet, and this year we had anticipated, until several of our clients canceled our contracts, to produce about 4,552 linear feet of
space. Peter, was that a conceptual artwork? Just here? I'm just kidding.
No, this is these are drawings that we produced just to sort of understand typologies of.
I think you could sell it.
You think so? No. Oh, I'm not an artist. we did these drawings just to sort of understand how big everything we made was over time. I guess the point was that we probably designed more art space in the last 5 years than any other architect in North America.
I like the wall-length one.
Yeah. Very phallic, I know. All right, so look, just really briefly, two projects. Christian Hay, who is a remarkable gallerist, invited us to, and when I say us, you know, I don't work alone, obviously, so I have an office, and I'm thankful for their collaborations with me, but invited us to renovate a small masonry building in Culver City at the corner of Venice and Comey, and this is shortly after Tim and Jeff opened Blum and Poe, so we had the opportunity, this was really our first commission, frankly, after moving back to LA from New York, we had the opportunity to design the project's West Coast venue in Culver City. And for those of you who know the gallery, it really is it's a private gallery that sometimes operates more like a nonprofit. It's not a criticism, in the sense that they really do promote and allow artists to be very provocative in terms of the sorts of works that they show, performances that they give, and an attitude towards the gallery that's very much about generating a public space and sphere. So here are just some shots of the interior, and as you can see the difference between these two shots, this is a show of Otto Muhl's work that was organized by Michelle Macaron, and here I think this is a, I can't see, but it's an early show of the project, it might be Jason Salvin. And so you can see the difference between the two shots is that we designed it so that the walls could come up and down and not be sort of very precious about how the space has been partitioned. Another interest that we had in working in Culver City, as you can see here, with the kind of polycarbonate crown that was developed along the top of the building was to sort of create a signage system that worked with the relatively disorganized aesthetic that exists in the neighborhood. About 2 years later, well, actually a year and a half later, LAX Art was launched on La Cienega, and it was another opportunity, working in collaboration with my partner, Lori Furstenberg, to renovate an existing warehouse space for use as a nonprofit art space. One of the interesting things, I think, about Lori's approach to the development of the space has been the kind of integration of the neighborhood. As you can see, the billboard here by Daniel Joseph Martinez. This is the first of a long series of uses and of that billboard by artists, but also Daniel, you know, had the idea very early on that he wanted to do a text piece on the facade, and so that was integrated into our architecture, and it's become, I suppose, the calling card for the space. This is the transformation of the facade over about 6 months as we peeled away the old fake brick veneer and replaced it with sort of shiny white plaster. And for those of you who know the space, the American Disabilities Act compliant entry zone is also utilized as a kind of art zone, as is the kind of window off to the left. And here you see Daniel Martinez's first installation, inaugural installation, in March or April of 2005. That's Daniel there on the evening of his opening. Needless to say, it's been a very interesting, these have been interesting opportunities for an architect to kind of engage with artists and with an art public, but, you know, they're all one-offs. So when I had the opportunity to teach here at USC, I really wanted to sort of look at the sort of status of the art district more analytically, and so what I did with this group of students was actually start to ask questions about 5 minutes. How art is kind of dispersed in Los Angeles. So this is an interesting study that shows proximity between kind of key art districts and Culver City. You see downtown on the right, Silver Lake, NoHo, Beverly Hills, West Hollywood, Santa Monica, Venice. And curiously enough, Culver City, perhaps its success has something to do with the fact that it is the kind of center point of several kind of art districts in Los Angeles. And it's been often repeated to me that for international collectors visiting Los Angeles, Culver City is a very convenient place to stop off on the way from the airport to your hotel in West Hollywood. And maybe that's why it's still thriving. But so, you know, we started doing these kind of studies. We looked at zoning, in particular, kind of before and after. One of our interests was sort of to see how the district, which is actually welded together between a kind of triangular wedge, which is part of Culver City, and an envelope, which is in the city of Los Angeles, which you see in blue, you see commercial, light industrial, and of course very little mixed use. And so one proposal that we offered the city was that in fact the major art corridors should be all moved to mixed use, and that low-income housing should be provided for artists. And of course, they kind of laughed at us a little bit. But the truth is that I think that you don't get sustainable arts-based communities unless artists live there. And I think that artists can't live there if real estate prices price them out. So it seems that, you know, as a project, policy, in a way, is a very interesting way to start to talk about how you make a sustainable community, less so design. If you can write into law provisions which actually allow or sustain art and make it a viable kind of component of a community, it seems that the likelihood then of the usual kind of flight that developers bring with them away from a community can be avoided. So our suggestion here was that eventually the district should move to 35% light industrial and to 65% mixed use, which would mean ideally that artists could live above their shop. Just an idea. Another thing that we were interested in understanding was really the relationship between greenery and urban space. This is a study that shows that in New York City, every individual has access to about, well, there are about 4.6 acres of green space per 1,000 people. In Los Angeles, more generally, there are 2.1 acres of green space per 1,000 people. And in Culver City, there are only 1.8 acres of green space per 1,000 people. So the follow-on from that was that really Culver City does not have enough green space. So here you see Central Park at scale in comparison to Griffith Park, and then, of course, the little sort of island of greenery on the right, Culver City. Our proposal then was to add elevated green space so that we could actually effectively possibly treble green space to about 10 acres. And so this is our final slide. It's subtle, but you know, if you imagined actually replanting all the available roof space in Culver City with greenery, you might produce a kind of new elevated public urban condition, which would ideally link what are right now disparate uses. So that's it.
Thank you, Peter. We're going to have a discussion, and then I'll open it up to questions in the audience very soon. We're probably going to go till about 9:15 or so this evening, so we do have some time for discussion and questions. I thought maybe one way to not unnaturally or inorganically tie certain strings together here, but to maybe throw out some questions, is maybe to ask Anne to reflect a little bit on the interrelationship, which I think Peter touched upon in terms of a history of the relationship between art, so-called art communities within New York, LA, and of course in other cities, as that's evolved over the past, you know, half century, let's say, to think about New York and to maybe think, not necessarily quantitatively, but perhaps qualitatively about the interrelationship between, whether you're speaking about Creative Time or other arts organizations, in terms of building communities within Manhattan, other boroughs in New York, and think about policy shifts that have taken place, changes in political leadership that have facilitated certain art projects within various spaces in New York, and the building, rebuilding, and dissolving of art communities as being an issue that maybe can be addressed. And of course, you know, LA, New York, apples and oranges to a certain extent, but the idea of growing communities and so-called gentrification and development are somewhat, I think, analogical to a certain extent. So maybe we can talk a little bit about that and how you see perhaps some of the complexities and contradictions there. Not to suggest that an art project is an incubator necessarily for the development of a community, but that we can see a history of transformation, whether it's Chelsea, Soho, and then also maybe to Peter, do all artists want to live where they produce, right? I mean, there's another issue as well. That has to go to lifestyle questions, which is not only within LA, but other cities as well, right? But that's as much rhetorical as a specific question. And then to kind of also talk with Doug a little bit about, you know, what it means to work within a city to, in some way, you know, create a kind of almost derealized kind of even urban existential kind of experience for people. Architecture as film, film as architecture. So those are some issues, or jump in and...
All right. That's a really big series of questions. I don't know really where to begin with that, but I would just say that I think that for cities to be engaging, creative places, it takes a multi-tiered approach. And I think one of the most fundamentally important approaches is the sort of illegal art or unpermissioned kind of work. And, you know, I live in Manhattan, I live in the East Village, and every day when I walk to work, which is also now in the East Village, I pass by this homeless artist who is a Vietnam vet, this guy named Jim Powers, who's been taking, you know, discarded plates and china cups and teapots and things, and mosaic them all over, you know, fire hydrants and planters and light posts. And every now and again, the Department of Transportation paints over these things, and I call complaining, because it doesn't take a lot of imagination not to paint over these fabulous mosaics. This is illegal art, and it's fabulous, and it makes my daily commute really creative. And then you have all the sort of street artists like Swoon and all the new decalady artists. Is that a new term? I just made it up, maybe. I think I might have read it. You know, who are liking like decal kind of art. There's a lot of stuff that's out there that I think we tend to think is invisible within our city, but actually gives us, either consciously or subconsciously, this feeling that the city is a place for creativity. And without it, cities are really bland, and artists will not be living in bland cities. So it's really interesting to me that despite the incredible rise in real estate prices in New York City, artists are still coming to live there. I really thought that you know, under the Giuliani and Bloomberg administrations, that we were gonna see the death of the cultural scene and the death of New York City, because it was just too expensive for artists to live. And what I'm finding is that artists really wanna be there because, you know, there's a kind of energy and people are willing to express themselves in any kind of diversity of ways. I have one assistant who lives in an apartment with 22 other people. Do you know what she pays? Any guesses? $1,200 a month to live with 22 other people in Bushwick. And she's not complaining. She's really like high on the creativity of the city, go figure. So, you know, the only answer I have is that, you know, there's a kind of energy and people are willing to kind of create at all risk, and the city kind of, you know, enables this kind of thing. And you noticed I had the Christo's Gate slides from Central Park and Olafur Eliasson's waterfalls, which were not Creative Time projects, but I skipped over them. I forgot why I put them in there. But at any rate, you know, I think there's also this other tier approach where the city, from the top to, you know, the mayor to all his kind of commissioners, are also really supportive of culture, and they see the role that culture can play in having a city be alive and really for the public. And so the fact that after, you know, probably 30 years, Christo finally got permission to do his Gates project in Central Park is not insignificant. There was a mayor and an administration from the top on down that said, make it happen. And an artist who really persevered, for better or worse.
Are you, there was one thing that, I'm not sure if this is accurate, but that you were doing the Art in the Anchorage project for quite a few years. Did that cease primarily as a result of security concerns post 9/11? That's one broader issue, because of course doing projects within particular sort of so-called open areas within cities, there's always a sort of contestation, right, between permissions and action. You know, of course there's guerrilla work that you're discussing, but are you concerned also moving forward in terms of fiscal crisis potentially, and also change in political leadership, which happens, you know, obviously within recessionary times, and more that permissions in a sense will be not simply in terms of financial issues or in terms of issues of capital, but perhaps other more sort of contractions of vision will
Absolutely.
Be occurring?
We, you know, Creative Time existed doing projects primarily without permission for the first, you know, 25 years of its existence, especially under Rudy Giuliani's reign of terror over New York City. I hate Rudy Giuliani. I say it publicly at every single lecture, and it gives me such satisfaction. And there are these moments where even as a, you know, fairly reputable organization that, you know, if the leadership of the city is not supportive of art and culture and ideas and freedom and democracy and all those things that I really like, then, you know, you're kind of in trouble. We're very lucky right now that we've been able to do projects like Doug's Sleepwalker project, which could not have happened under a different administration. So, and yes, post 9/11, the Brooklyn Bridge Anchorage, where we had programmed for over 20 years, was closed due to national security concerns, which was ridiculous because you could drive over the Brooklyn Bridge with a truck full of C4 and do a lot of damage, but you could only walk into the Brooklyn Bridge Anchorage with a backpack full of C4 and kill me and hurt some artwork. So, you know, but at any rate, there's a lot of kind of ridiculous regulation stuff that you have to deal with that's a part of our reality that limits the kinds of projects that we can do that's neither logical or fair very often. But I'm really pro illegal art, and a lot of young artists are here, and maybe illegal is a tough term, but, you know, unsanctioned. Be free. And by the way, you know, this is an economy. Don't look to anybody to fund your projects. It's just not going to happen. You know, over the past few years, there's been, like, such ridiculousness. I had this artist. I hope he's not here. Couldn't even remember his name, so I hope he's not here and I'm not offending him. But he came to me with this proposal to create a huge Ferris wheel, and each of the, like, cars on the Ferris wheel would be a condo, and the idea was that I would produce this and find a developer, and he was, like, totally serious. Like, who wants to live on a condo Ferris wheel, and who's going to build that, and are you out of your mind? So, like, stop being so spoiled and get out there and do your own thing and make your community and your city alive. It's your responsibility. Do it, and it'll be exciting.
That brings that. I mean, I want to give Peter the floor in a moment, but that brings up an interesting issue, which I was thinking about.
I don't want the whole floor.
Okay. there is an idea. I mean, amongst art, you know, art projects produced within cities, you know, across the United States, and I think also within certain European situations, that in terms of also sustainability, that if one were to do a more permanent project, let's say 25 years in length, that somehow that builds community, that sustains the public's interest in art. And I wonder if that's an issue that might be discussed as well in terms of more temporary, ephemeral projects in terms of the rebuilding of communities, or the rebuilding of areas, because I think there's some contradictions there that we might want to explore. But
that's more
for Peter. Yeah. I mean the idea that it's one thing to, okay. I mean, it's one thing to sort of instantiate or create art institutions and galleries and not-for-profits to and then to build in, hopefully with some type of planning or rule or laws and regulations, a community around that or in relation to that. But I mean, how does one then think about that in terms of impermanence as well?
Look, I mean, I don't think that policy has to only translate into something like inflexibility, or that policy means that things can't change or be ephemeral or be illegal. But I think the point that I was making was that, you know, essentially artists and gallerists have done a lot of good work for developers in raising the kind of property values of their communities, only to see themselves kind of given the boot at the end of the process. And, you know, I think that we're now in a cycle, interestingly enough, where that may not happen for a long time. I also think that we're in a political environment in which maybe at last we might find public and perhaps even administrative support for the arts. That's shocking, but it seems that it might be on the table, which suggests to me that rather than thinking about a kind of reactive, piecemeal approach to making cities and including culture there, usually as the 1%, which I think is really offensive, that we could think about art as the 100% or 99%, that we don't have to sort of only see the development of cities as being about the production of capital and value, but that culture is a different sort of value. And if culture itself, or its production, or its protagonists were engaged in a different way, perhaps the issue of sustainability might be more to do with, you know, you could say permanent impermanence, for instance. I don't necessarily believe that artists have to live where they work, but I certainly think that artists have to live somewhere and that they should be supported in that endeavor. And I do feel that art and architecture should not just be an instrument for the generation of value. And certainly for the last 10 years, architecture has been spectacular, art has been spectacular, but quite often it's been liminally effective in terms of producing new social circumstances. So that might sound very kind of idealistic and utopian, but I certainly think that the other model obviously has failed. So, you know, where we go from here, I think, might be an interesting sort of, there are an interesting series of questions that could be asked now. If you reran, for instance, the last boom, would you do differently?
I mean, the model. Well, I'm not sure what. I think I understand which model you're alluding to. I mean, it's failed, but it's also succeeded. I mean, it's contradictory, right? I mean, capital can serve, right, the production of challenging art projects and other kinds of cultural endeavors, but it can also become, right, its own justification. So I think that it cuts both ways. I mean, that's sort of, I think, where we find ourselves today is not, we're sort of searching for a method, and we're searching for, I think, a way to sort of rethink how capital can be re-instrumentalized in relation to the production of challenging projects. You know,
sure, but I think as a starting point, art and architecture thought of as anything but a commodity might be very interesting. Because, you know, as a commodity, we lose value. But I think that if you were to instantiate, as you said, new social circumstances, for instance, perhaps through policy, not necessarily through aesthetics, we might find that a sustainable model would produce new aesthetics, for instance. And I mean in an urban way, right?
Sure.
So
I think the question of policy is a really interesting one. It sounds so boring, but in fact, I think there's opportunity right now, especially, I hate to be overly optimistic, with the new president who seems to be supportive of culture. And by the way, I hope you all heard that the NEA just got the biggest increase in my lifetime of $50 million. Yeah, which is really great. I'm big pro NEA because it's the money, even though it's tied to the government, that's the freest for us. But at any rate, that's a whole other conversation. But the question of policy, I think, is an interesting one. How many of you are aware locally of Edgar Arsenault's project for Watts Community? Yeah, oh, I'm so glad to hear that. You know, it's a really interesting project because, you know, it's modeled after other projects like, you know, Project Row Houses by Rick Lowe in Houston, really interesting experiment, very successful. Watts has its own particular problems from the little bit that I know. For example, not all the residents own their properties. Many of them are renting. So what happens when you start to improve and sort of give a facelift to the neighborhood is the threat of what you talked about, of gentrification. So are there new methods that we can come up and propose new policies about how there's a kind of investment if you contribute to the betterment of a neighborhood? Is there some kind of benefit that you receive back, not only in terms of feeling good about participating in an art project and, you know, making your neighborhood more lovely, but maybe there's some kind of credits or something that you can get that ultimately helps you put a down payment on, you know, a mortgage within that very neighborhood. There may be models out there in this country that I'm not aware of. More likely, there are probably models in other countries around the world. But I think that we should take a look at, and since cities are not going to be investing in poor neighborhoods during this economic crisis that's going to last a good long time, this might be a good opportunity to crack open a door for some new models, depending on who's in our elected offices. You know, just sort of a thought, but I don't think it's necessarily about the gallery districts. It's
Absolutely.
Also about artists working within community, and I don't think permanent sculptures or community murals are the only way to look at this, and I think Edgar's an interesting model.
No, absolutely. I mean, coincidentally, students that I work with here in the next semester at USC work with Edgar on the Watts Art House project, and one of the things that we identified was really the issue was less about, you know, you already have a great piece of art there in some ways, so we looked at amenities. You know, what amenities could actually be brought to the neighborhood that are permanent and that are useful for residents? And some of those things are very simple, like, you know, a new driveway or a better gate. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't have to be something spectacular, but all of those things I think Edgar is trying to tackle also as art projects.
Edgar is working with our students at this point. But I guess that also goes to the issue of what, I mean, we that's a, one would say to a certain extent, as the New Orleans context and perhaps others within this country are more sort of areas of crisis, if you will, and that require particular treatment, and of course, the collaboration. I mean, Rick Lowe's project in Houston is a very good example, and that's been a highly successful model, I think predominantly because of who Rick Lowe is as a person, a communicator. But I think that requires a very special talent, and whether it can be replicated in other situations, and it shouldn't certainly be mandated for artists. It has to really come from a commitment to location and place, ultimately. Maybe we should open up to the audience and have some question and answers and little, maybe even provocations. We have a couple of microphones. One is here, and one I think is already in the back.
I think, Josh,
yeah.
There's one thing that I'm thinking about when you guys are talking, which is I don't think this discussion should be limited to New York City and Los Angeles.
Right.
And I also don't feel like it should be about looking for infrastructures to fund your art or other ways like that. I mean, to make an artwork, you've got to will it into existence, you know, mm-hmm. and you can use any tool necessary.
Bravo.
Okay. That's a good point.
Okay, who, all the way in the back, I think, is that Carol? Carol Stakanos?
Hello.
Somebody, thank you.
So, I had the pleasure of working with Anne at Creative Time for a decade, and one of the things that I've found extremely exciting since I have not been in the inner fold has been the decision to move the organization nationally and now globally. And I guess, Doug, I think that...
You just outed us, Carol.
Oh. I seem to do that a lot lately. Anyway, you know, I think Doug's point as well that it isn't only about New York and Los Angeles, but, you know, when I hear you speaking about a vision of going global, I'm wondering if you can just slow down for a minute and kind of explain to us a little bit about how does an organization that's had a three-decade commitment to one city and understanding what it means to commit to a place begin to take that model to other cities and engage with local communities? I know that the Paul Chan project might be a really great place to rest for a moment as well, because those kinds of questions come up. What does that mean in a community like Los Angeles?
Well, let me just tell you a little bit about the origins of why we started to move nationally. First of all, New York City is blessed to have at least 5 public arts presenters. Creative Time was the first, and no longer is it the only. And New York City is a big place, so 5 public art presenters isn't too crowded. It's not like 200 galleries in Chelsea. But, you know, it felt like there's a big world. And, you know, Creative Time is very much about following artists' leads, following their dreams, helping to nurture their ideas. And so why should we be limited to place? And we did a project. You saw the images of the Jenny Holzer projections on the New York Public Library. And it was a little upsetting for me that people didn't flock to see the project, or people who were walking by Rockefeller Center, New York Public Library, Penn Station, Cooper Union, St. John the Divine, Central Park, wherever we did these projections, would go, oh, that looks cool, and keep going. I think that New Yorkers, in a way, have come to many of them have come to expect interesting things to happen and so don't value them as much. And I thought, well, what happens if we were to do this in Kansas City or, you know, Detroit or, you know, other cities around the country? And so we decided we would do a little experiment. We're not, you know, very well versed yet. It's only been a little over a year that we've started to work nationally. But it's really not so much about the cities we want to work in. It's about the artists we want to work with and where they want to go and what their ideas are. So that's number one. In terms of going global, it was much the same kind of conversation. Well, if we're really so artist-centered and we're interested in artists' ideas, again, why should we be limited by place? Plus, you know, artists are global citizens today. You guys are incredibly lucky. I mean, Doug is almost rarely in LA compared to traveling around, you know. Okay, I won't use you as an example because I don't know if you've been to Papua New Guinea for the art fair, have you? Or Qatar for the new museum, or Abu Dhabi for the, you know, the fair, or, you know, Venice and Berlin and London for the biennials, and blah, blah, blah. Artists are in an incredibly privileged position today to have many exhibition venues like never before in history. And what does it mean
to engage with these different places. Again and again, artists told us, we fly in, we install our work, we talk to curators, we're tired of curators and collectors, and then we just go back to the, or go off to the next place. And so it's like, well, these are interesting cultures to engage with. You know, so the question became, where do you want to go? What do you want to explore? What do you want to do? So what we're doing is a pilot program right now and funding 6 artists over the next 2 years to go where they want, to sort of nurture their own process. It's kind of like a mobile residency. It's nothing glamorous or groundbreaking or anything about it, but it's about letting artists lead and not having institutional agendas tell them where to go. And then the idea is they somehow or other come back. Maybe we do a lecture, we do a book. I'm not quite sure what it is yet, but we're going to learn from their process and start to think of ourselves as a global organization. And it may backfire, but it's just an experiment. Did that answer your question, Carol? We're following the artist.
Some questions from... anyone? Our students? Our outside guests? I did not plant any questions. But I did plan students.
There. There's a brave person all the way in the back.
Well, I mean, oh, there is? Okay. Yeah. I'm sorry, I can't, there's a light in my eyes, so I can't see everything.
Hi. It seems as though the city of Los Angeles has quite a few built-in art corridors already that aren't being used in the form of freeways. And I was wondering, do you think there's any potential of art organizations somehow getting behind, rather artists getting behind the production or the pushing of the development of infrastructure whereby you would have maybe on the Santa Monica Freeway 10 digital billboards that would be assigned specifically for the use in a permanent way but always changing with different curators. It would be assigned for the use of producing a sort of ongoing art display. Is something like that possible, or is that...
Well, as you probably know, the freeways are controlled by Caltrans, so they're not the property of the city of Los Angeles. But actually, LAX Art, 2 years ago, I believe now, did a piece with Ruben Ochoa on the 101 East, I believe. It was very difficult, though, because there are numerous restrictions.
Do you think those restrictions could be changed? It seems like the
I think they could, but I think that you're dealing with transportation engineers primarily who don't have a stake in a civic discussion. They have a stake in an infrastructural. Coincidentally, the program that I coordinate at Sci-Fi, which is the Future Initiatives program, is sponsoring a competition with the Architects newspaper to respond to Measure R, which is the half-cent sales tax, which should generate $40 billion for new infrastructure in Los Angeles. And one of the questions that we're asking competitors to consider is transportation, you know, as a generator for, or transportation infrastructure as a generator for public space, and not to think about freeways and streets and railway lines merely as kind of an engineering problem, but to think about them in terms of their relationship to things like communities and civic spaces. So. You can see that on our website. But interestingly enough, I mean, we've attracted Gail Goldberg's interest. She's on the jury. Cecilia Estolano, Gail is the director of planning at the City of Los Angeles. Cecilia Estolano is the CEO of the CRALA. I think that, you know, right now is an interesting time to think about a kind of WPA-style project. But keep in mind that we're dealing with a city that specifically has divorced infrastructure from public space. You know, the design of freeways, for better or worse, has divided communities in LA, hasn't conjoined them. You know, could art improve that? Maybe. But, you know, there's an upkeep issue also that always gets sort of tabled when artists try to make art on freeways.
Publicly sanctioned work is, you know, it's difficult territory. Rarely, it happens, but rarely is great art a result of a public commission. There's just too many political agendas too conservative, too many material concerns. Is it graffiti proof? Will somebody try to scratch it? Will a child get his head stuck in the fence? You know, it's like amazing. It's just too many restrictions on artists. So while I'm glad that those programs exist, you know, I would say 98% of the time it really doesn't produce, and that's optimistic, good art, let alone great art, and very often horrible art. And artists are at their best when they're freed from those limitations. And, you know, the idea of digital billboards, you know, everybody comes up with that idea. It's a fine idea, but it's not going to happen because somebody's got to program it. Somebody's got to maintain it. They'll find every bureaucratic reason, every city, not, I'm not talking about L.A. I know no idea about L.A., but not to do it. And L.A. is a very, very hard city to have a lot of, you know, really exciting public programming because there's no center there. There's no there. It's a car city, which is why the idea of using the freeways is a good idea.
That's a New Yorker's attitude to L.A. Come on, we've changed.
Okay. I'll take his word for it.
I mean, really?
Yeah.
You still buy that?
Yeah.
There's no there?
No, but I think it's a very sprawling city, and it's primarily a car culture.
No, it's a series of cities. It's not one big city. If you see it as a series of communities, then it's far more manageable.
Which is why I like the idea of working within community in LA.
Right.
I don't think spectacular projects like, you know, Christo's Gates and stuff.
So you think local fabric is still a more effective way for artists to kind of engage?
I think it's an effective way. Yeah.
Right.
I'm not saying it's the only way. I think it's a really effective and totally undervalued way, and you're not going to see that work covered in Art Forum or Frieze or in the museums or anything like that. It's not glamorous, but it's really interesting.
Oh, it gets coverage there as well, these more urban fabric. We have some questions here, down here, please. Can we have the mic down here?
Oh, I just had one question, which was, I just wondered if the panelists, I really appreciate the discussion. I was just wondering if the panelists could just reflect a little bit on what we mean when we say public. I mean, that's one thing that hasn't really been addressed is this, there's a kind of agreed upon sense of what publicness is, and I'm just curious to hear from each of you about what that means.
I'm interested in less the let's say material specifics of public space per se than this issue of what happens, the kind of experience that takes place within particular situations, and how obviously one can shift one's experience from experiencing something as a more private enclave to something that's so-called more public. So it's less about space, less about kind of the materiality of place than it is about a certain kind of experiential relationship to that. And then further, to go back to a kind of Habermasian sense of the public sphere, which has been debated certainly, and we talk about sort of agonistic space and spaces of critical debate and struggle, which is all part of it, but I do think that, again, it's not about inside or outside, ultimately. It's about the kind of the experience and the discussion and the discourse and the experiences that are generated in particular situations and which galvanize broader constituencies to have a broader-based discussion, whether it's in this place or on the street or in a gallery or in a museum or in an airport. I think it's a character of so-called public discourse that ultimately determines the character of our culture and the character of our cities. And that fundamentally is about education. And that's, I think, the missing link, ultimately.
Doug, you should take that one.
We don't have to answer that question.
That's, pretty much sums it up. I mean, public, you know, I think when we were talking earlier, I was wondering to myself, at what point is an artwork truly public? You have something which is in a gallery, is that public art? You know, at what point, you know, does it have to be outside of the museum, outside of the gallery? Does it have to be temporal, permanent? I had this kind of amazing breakfast in New York last weekend with this man who invented DIA in 1973 and DIA Art Foundation. And he was kind of this visionary that showed up, you know, on Amplified Level 11, You know, like you couldn't even talk to him. And he was just so passionate. And when he left my apartment, he said, and you got to think this guy's, he's in his late 70s or something like that. He said, you know, I'm going to die soon, but I want you to know that I want to leave more behind than I took. And I think that's really, you know, it's kind of what this is all about.
I have to follow that.
No, you don't. No, we don't have to do this. I mean, I think it's a relevant question.
Well, okay, I'll answer the question. Look, I think
I want to give some of the students an opportunity to
in Los Angeles. Right now. I think that the term public is highly contentious, and as an illustration of it, I think that some of our most public spaces are our freeways, our beaches, and our malls. You know, and if you go to, I'm being serious. If you go follow, you know, the travails of our famous developer Rick Caruso and his work at The Grove, where he produced a private space that kind of looks like a public space and operates for a lot of people like a public space. You can do mommy and me classes there. There's a park and there's water. And you can congregate and you can actually be around your peers, which is, I think, public activity. Now, if you go to Americana at Brand, which is in Glendale, he's kind of upped the ante because what he's done is he's wrapped a public space, a genuinely public space, a park that's owned by the city of Glendale with a mall. And as Christopher Hoffman pointed out, it's a public space in drag as a kind of private space trying to be a public space. And that's why it works. Because we all like to be hoodwinked into believing that, you know, in Los Angeles we could actually have public experiences.
And I got in trouble for what I said.
And you want to add or can you want to add?
No, I think you did it.
Okay.
It's unknowable. It's not something we can define like we can't define community. There's no agreement. We just, you know, reinterpret it every time we experience it.
Okay. Guess down here, please. Mike's down here. Did you have a question? Yeah.
Uh-oh. You guys briefly covered this, but going back to the conversation that Peter and Anne were having about community in LA and either being a one large city or a series of small communities, thinking about the community, especially in LA, going beyond like geographical conceptions of it, I think it's particularly relevant to Los Angeles, but it can be attributed to like national and international kind of concepts of community. Do you kind of see those, the spread of kind of a virtual community being an obstacle or an opportunity for artists to engage people?
Opportunity. Yeah. Don't you? What do you think?
I agree with that, but thinking about just the debate of whether or not, you know, Los Angeles can truly function as kind of a series of unique experiences mm-hmm. within such a sprawling place, like how do we connect?
Well, I mean, you know, the funny thing is if you look at new open source tools like crowdsourcing or like LimeWire, all these things that basically do peer-to-peer stuff, they're pretty seamless. But if you look at public space, it's not. It's a series of discontinuous experiences. And one of the things that's interesting about LA is that the things we do share are sometimes the things that we would see as deficits, like traffic jams. For instance, I was telling my students at Sire today that a transportation planner decided to study how long it would take to get from downtown Newport Beach to downtown Los Angeles. And if you drive by yourself in a car, you can do it like in 45 minutes if you line things up nicely. But if you try to take the bus, because there's so many discontinuous systems, it takes 8 hours. And what's interesting is that all of these cities that we call Southern California are conceived of as independent, and yet they share mutual problems. Now, Mark Gordon, who's the founder of LimeWire, is now trying to apply open source tools to issues like public transportation to see if, rather than using planners, who traditionally are pretty incompetent sometimes in dealing with big, complicated problems, what if you could just hand it over to the public and allow them to deal with it through something like blogging or, you know, community activism online. But truthfully, I think that the kind of interface yet to policy is not there. We're starting to see its effect, obviously, in online communities. in their ability to deal with things like elections quite successfully. But we haven't yet found a way to transmute those tools into something like planning initiatives.
Can I just jump in and say that one word that I found productive in thinking about community is enclave, which suggests, I mean, communities are enclaves, but enclaves are also something different. They don't necessarily have to constitute community. And it seems that within any city, whether it's a more spread out city such as LA or a more concentrated city like New York or kind of in between place like Chicago or other situations, that you really have a kind of the issue of continuity or discontinuity regarding enclaves, right? They're temporary communities as well as more so-called sustained or permanent communities. There's also shift in populations. And I guess the issue is one can deal with sort of localities, the notion of a community as a locality, or a community as something that's delocalized through different kind of patterns of migration or labor, work, and life. And I think that it's more complicated in LA, I think, than in other cities because of the vast distances. But then the question is, what do these, you know, I mean, I agree with you, Peter, that these technologies can be utilized in terms of peer-to-peer, but does that mean that these enclaves that are established by individuals and then that grow organically within broader communities, whether it's a block or a subdivision or what have you, mm-hmm. are going to be somehow broken down by those new peer-to-peer technologies, or whether, in fact, those literal material bricks and mortar enclaves will be reinforced, whereas the Facebooks, you know, actually open up virtual communities in a different way? It's complicated.
But there's a difference between voyeurism, which I think is what happens in online communities, and being able to cobble together what are, I think enclaves are interest groups in my mind. And one of the barriers, I think, often to civic development in this city is that you run into too many interest groups. And they're not necessarily, by the way, always drawn along economic or racial lines. I mean, quite often there are other factors of interest. But traditionally, if you think about barriers to things like the subway to the sea, I mean, quite often it's you know, not in my backyardism. There's another term called bananas, but I can't remember what the acronym means. But what it exacerbates, I think, is the perpetual re-identification by community of deficits, right, that might be shared. But we have yet in this city to move to a model in which you can corral that energy towards being productive or projective as opposed to being reactive. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay, do we have more questions? We're going to wrap up in just a minute or two.
There's one back there.
Okay.
Josh really wants to wrap this up.
Did you have a phone? Mia, did you have a question?
I just guess what's interesting to me is that this kind of discussion has moved from public art to kind of public culture issues in terms of kind of the social needs of communities and so forth. And I'm wondering if you guys could comment on whether you get that feeling, because I know you guys did talk about with the New York question about in the 70s whether art would change a city or change how a city will respond to a city's or a citizen's kind of social needs and so forth. I'm just wondering if you can now comment on what public culture means in terms of how you guys see it now.
I mean, when does culture become public, so to speak? That's a very difficult.
I'm actually not clear what the question is. Yeah. I'm sure you're being very clear, but maybe it's my jet lag. I'm not clear.
Well, just in terms of. Because the title of the presentation was kind of public art and public art and architecture in public spaces, but
that's actually not or public art. Does okay? That's
art
not the title, but okay.
In public spaces.
Let's just pretend
maybe
you're
jet.
Go
maybe
ahead,
he's jet lag. I don't know. But
in terms of what you guys mean by public
Doug,
culture,
what's the title?
In terms of what it now means and how it's transformed into, is it? Are you talking more about kind of linking it to just kind of a community's needs in terms of how they want to fit into a city, like integration policies or how?
You know, it's so hard to make generalizations. I don't believe in one size fits all kinds of models at all. I really think it's a case-to-case kind of situation and artist to artist. So I'm not trying to evade your question. I just think already we've been kind of too general in some ways. So I just don't really know how to answer that. Maybe somebody in the audience wants to, or else on the panel wants to take that one on.
Did you want to?
Yeah, we have a question down here, and then we're going to have to wrap it up. I'm sorry. Back up here. Thanks.
Microphones make me nervous. I guess the question I have is sort of around engagement, and I'm wondering, coming from three, you know, very different perspectives, you know, as artists, a curator, architect, but all producing projects for the public, what are the kind of discussions that go on about, you know, the distinctions between types of engagement, and is that something that, you know, that you're addressing? And I mean this kind of on practical terms, just like how are those conversations sort of formulated? Are those conversations even part of your sort of individual
Do
practices?
Do you mean engagement with the process or the audience?
No, I mean with your audience, yeah, with the public. Not without having to define that, I guess. I just mean, yeah.
Go ahead, Doug.
I mean, maybe the answer is no. I don't. I mean, I'm just wondering if that's something that comes up, and if it does, then how is that conversation sort of hashed out in your individual practices?
I mean, I think you make a work with the intent to create a series of questions, a series of provocations. You create a work to make a stimulant in a way, and you know, that's something that, you know, someone may be interested in, they may feed off of, or they may not. So in a lot of ways, I don't find that I really, I don't really, you know, read reviews or anything like that too much, you know, but I do really like it when I run into someone who's come across a work. I love the unexpected, you know, I love the unexplained. I love this idea that you can discover something, you know, that's still in our world that's so regulated and processed, you know, that there can be an enigma somewhere, you know. And I think in a lot of ways that, for me, much of the beauty of art is not about having a possession or an object, but it's about taking a kind of Polaroid in my mind and living with that. Mm. You know, I might think about a work, and I don't really give a shit if it's a public work or a piece in a gallery, but that image of Nelman's hand to mouth, for example, you know, maybe I've been in a room with it for 30 minutes, 30 seconds of my life, but it reverberates, and it has a kind of resonance, and it continues to provoke and question me. And as I grow as a person, my relationship with that work and its meaning may grow. Some pieces die off, you know. I think in a lot of ways, art can be also be very temporal. It can be, it can have a lifespan, you know. And in a lot of ways, we ask a lot from an artwork when we ask it to have that same meaning, you know, sustain and be with us. I can see a work like Monet's Water Lilies at MoMA, and for me it doesn't do it. You know, I don't have that relationship with it. However, I can completely appreciate where it was at that time or for how others it really had that quality. I can see at Keenholz State Hospital or a Bastionator piece, and it is completely alive, you know. So I think your question kind of goes much deeper than, you know, how does the public react with an actual work of art, but it's more philosophical. How do you, as an individual, how do you relate with an artwork, and what do you seek from it?
So I'm going to answer that question on the pragmatic side of things, because you asked in our process if we consider audience.
So not if you consider audience, but if there's distinctions that are made between the types of engagements that you're creating for various audiences. Like, do you understand what I mean?
Well, go ahead, give an example.
I guess in Creative Times projects, I mean, there's certain projects like Paul Chan's that involve this sort of God, this is
I mean,
difficult.
You could think of Ulliffer's piece as being a piece. It's like very populist in a sense. Mm-hmm. I mean, just to...
Are you thinking about the bridge?
Are you talking about participation?
So the point is that with every project, tell me if I'm answering the question, with every project, we do think about audience and we think about it differently. Mm-hmm. So we think about what is the artist's intention with this project. So in New Orleans, Paul very much wanted to give a moment of sort of beauty for people and to say, we have not forgotten about you, we care about you. And to give them, hopefully, a beautiful experience with art, number one. Number two, we wanted to keep the national spotlight on New Orleans, regardless of anniversary sort of moments. And there were some other agendas as well, but those were the primary agendas. And so we thought, okay, if we want to give a beautiful experience to these people and tell them that they matter to us and we haven't forgotten, then we need to really carefully listen to them, understand what they've been through, what their experiences are, what their histories are, what their needs are, and decide what we can do with an artwork, because you can't solve all problems, right? It is just art after all. So that would be an example of really like listening to community. When you're dealing with a big project like Ulliffer's Waterfalls, you're thinking about audience much more generally. And then the idea is, how do you create strategies to be able to expose as many people to the awareness that this is happening and why it's happening? Press becomes, for example, a critical sort of partner in terms of informing the public that something is happening. So for us at Crave Time, every single project we do, we have to say, what is the artist's intention? Who is this meant to reach? How do we try to think about audience? And you know, in our case, we're only an organization of 10 people. We can't do it all, but we try to do the best we can. And if we don't ask ourselves those questions, we'll fail the artist, we'll fail the artwork, we'll fail the public, almost guaranteed.
I think we have to.
Go
ahead.
You're not allowed to.
I don't know if architects have audiences. I mean, we have clients, which is fundamentally, in some ways, a different way of staging a relationship with the public, because there's always a kind of intermediary. But I mean, certainly in the case of working with public art organizations, for instance, the University of California, Riverside. I mean, there's a discussion, but it's not a direct discussion with an audience. It's a discussion generally with a representative of that audience. So ambitions like, you know, the gallery should be inviting or public or should promote interaction are things that are delivered to you, you know, as a brief or as a challenge, you know, for an architect to resolve. But I guess, I mean, in the best way, I mean, with the galleries that, you know, we're happiest with, I mean, audience are ultimately artists who use them. And I'm most pleased when artists say that we produce art spaces that support their work. And that's why I use the word facilitate as opposed to create, right?
Just one comment. I mean, there's also this issue which will be, I think, brought up in the follow-up panel on April 6th, which will have architect Teddy Cruz, artist Christoph Wodisko, and artist and architect Marjetica Petorek from Slovenia. But this issue of bottom-up versus top-down, right, architecture, and it seemed that what the question perhaps was also getting to was the issue of public engagement also in terms of participatory processes, right? And that does, I think, go to Peter, to your sort of invoking issues of how communities, both virtual and actual, can participate in the production of their own spaces or their own environments. And I think that certainly certain aspects of participatory art practice also sort of ask that question, right, in one way or another. I'm afraid that, I mean, we could go on for a long time, but we only really have the space till 9 o'clock, so we already pushed it. I want to thank everyone for coming this evening and the panelists, and see you soon. Thank you very much.